So the remark is French, which is Latin in substance, but has in form. In French, not originally, or has come in books that you have to learn in the European, and that's what you get. You do that. Okay, so much for my analogy. I turn to another topic, which is copies, to words for to be. Roman languages with two copies of the type Sara and Star are the following: Portuguese, Galician, Castilian, Catalan, Italian, Sicilian, and Old French, the philosopher. Again, you do not find it in Romanian, but it's in Eastern Romance, and it is important, and only in Western Romance. You have it in Celtic, for example, in Middle Welsh. For Middle Welsh, you have the inheritance paradigm, the S paradigm, and a new paradigm, the D paradigm. Why do you find it? It's not in the European literature, it's an innovation. You even find it in Old English. You have the American S paradigm, and then the D paradigm, the new one, and the explanation is that it was acquired by the Old English on the basis of Celtic substrates. Because the English, as you know, are Celts, Scotland, Anglo-Saxon. There are ideas of Rome, which is English, but with Celtic features. And what feature is the second popular paradigm? And you have traces of the second paradigm, the plating of the paradigm is called inscriptions in Old Saxon and Old Saxon, the B form of this is not a Germanic feature. Germanic, both Germanic have only single paradigm, as is the European paradigm. And both Icelandic and Gothic, the northern and easternmost Germanic languages, preserve the single paradigm that they inherit. They don't have the second paradigm, the copy. So then, summing up, we have the language of the two copulas in the Western Celtic, we don't know what it is in West Germanic, on the Celtic substrate, and Western Roman. And that are, those are exactly the languages for which I think we must assume it has come in substrate. No? That's because it has two popular paradigms, and I quote, Math makes a distinction between Isan and Egon. Isan and Egon. Transient properties are assigned by the word Egon to be an expectation, whereas standing properties are assigned to the word Isan. The distinction, which is for the most part limited to Western land, is reminiscent to the one found in Spanish between Seven and Star. And some people, of course, think it's in that the Spanish picture. I think it's the other way around. I think that in the European languages, which don't have two paradigms to begin with, acquired it from the error of the past, from the chronic substrate. And the fact that it's now stronger, the paradigm approach is stronger in Western Latin and Eastern Latin, has to do by later stabilization of the paradigm in contact with Spanish and weakening of the paradigm in Eastern Latin in contact with French, which gave up the second copula early on, with only two phrases staying in the present paradigm. The correspondence between Castilian Sarastar and that of Isa Eman has often been noted. The correspondences with the other Romance languages are either not mentioned or seen as embarrassing for a subsequent explanation, which has been attended in the past. But the Vasconic theory, which posits a large Vasconic substrate in Western Europe, supports substrate explanation. There is, in fact, to my knowledge, no other explanation. There exists a fine indirect confirmation of the substrate, whereas standard English gave up the old English to popular syntax. By conflating the two popular paradigms into one, we have the deformed in D and DIN, that's possible, and otherwise you have the old inherited S form, is Irish English in recent centuries developed new dual popular paradigms on its Celtic substrate. It's proof that the paradigms of this sort can be acquired by Celtic. So much of possible to consciousness and turn to the third structure and beyond accent. A Proto-European had a very old accent. The accent could go on everything with the word had to that went. In three, and only three of the Indo-European language subfamilies were this way of accentuation given up in favor of a sixth initial accent, namely the first syllable accent. In Germanic, in Italic, including pre-Islamic Latin, and in Celtic, that is, again, in the three westernmost Indo-European languages. The shift to initial accent is best accounted for as a Sprachkunst phenomenon. Since there is no language internal explanation for the development of initial accent, the Sprachkunst language contact with non-European languages has been held responsible for nearly 100 years. The word initial accent, by the way, also occurred in Etruscan, is conceived by the reduction of the word. It's never the first syllable that's reduced, it's the second or the fourth syllable that are reduced, which is typical of initial first accent. That's indeed what you find in the books, it's not in there. But it's not unimportant because Etruscan, nor the first, is again a Western European language. But it's an Indo-European language or a European language. The Western European plus Etruscan, therefore the accent shift for the Western European Sprachkunst phenomenon. And my thesis is that this new accentual system was owed to a shared substrate with initial accent. Now what's the accent in Basque? Of course in modern Basque there are plenty of accents and it's not an initial accent at all. It's more like a final or final accent in the standard accent. Many different systems in the dialect. But what about an early form of that? Now, fortunately for my theory, a very important linguist, Henri Martinet, said many years ago that protopast had initial accent, and the first syllable accent, and the other systems that we have now developed much later, not too long before that. Another linguist, Gordon Michelina, also said initial accent, but he said it was probably second syllable accent, and he gave arguments. Now, a linguist who you probably know, Jose Ignacio, well, said, well, Proto-Basque didn't have any word accent at all, it had more like a phrase level quality as in modern French, so that French doesn't have word accent. Now, one of his results does not preclude the existence of a word accentual system with initial accent at a still earlier stage. As a matter of fact, you have a parallel of that. French. French has this phrase level property without a word accent, and it derived from Latin, which at an early stage had no initial accent. So that would be what the parallel. So nothing speaks against the assumption of an initial accent in very early there's a strong linguistic argument for a phrase of past to a syllable accent. That's a constraint for, there's two constraints for trisyllabic words, words with three syllables. The first constraint says, well, you may have two consonants between the second and the third syllable, but you must not have two consonants you may have it between the first and the second, but you must not have it between the second and the third. There you can only have a single consonant. Now, having two consonants after a vowel is a syllabic complexity. And syllabic complexities are better tolerated in the vicinity of accent than in the vicinity of no accent. So that speaks in favor of first syllable accent. The accent cannot have been on the second syllable, because you wouldn't have that constraint otherwise. The other constraint is, well, even that consonant, that single consonant between second and third syllable, cannot be a strong consonant. Cannot be a close to. It has to be a weaker cousin than that. Again, that speaks in favor of unaccented and not unaccented, in my opinion. Again, it speaks in favor of close to. So I think I'm in pretty good shape as far as accident regards with my theory, namely, there is evidence that very early that has come in and intro.